Good morning, everyone. Let's wait for a couple of minutes while we wait for everyone to join. This is the third video conference on the future of micro credentials. In a couple of minutes, Fernando, we will begin. It's 5:32 p.m. in Greece. So we'll wait for two more minutes so that we can have more participants with us. This is growing very fast. Now we have 85 participants who have joined. They're still joining. We have several participants from countries such as Brazil, Chile, Costa Rica, Guatemala. Here we have Ecuador. Here we have Darío, Igor. Hi to Chile Valora. Our colleagues, please be welcome. In the meantime, we want to tell you that our cameras are off and the microphones are muted. And we also have interpretation. So you have the icon on the bottom of the screen where you can select the language of the preference. I also want to say hi to Inade's team from Panama. I can see Liliana there, our Center for Consultant, who's also a consultant from the qualifications framework. We were talking about the relationship between MCs and qualifications frameworks. We have several colleagues from Sense who have joined us. We were lucky enough to contact the European Center for Professional Development, CEDEFOP, which is somehow, to put it in genetic terms, it's an institution that has the same DNA as Center for. So our mission is to support the development of TVET. And we were lucky enough to find Anastasia Pouliou, who has been so kind with us. She's been very generous in giving us her time for her presentation. She's an expert in qualifications and credentials. In CEDEFOP, she works in the beautiful city in Greece called Thessalonica. And you will see some of the pictures in her PowerPoint so that maybe you can go there and visit CEDEFOP one day. We will have Anastasia with us with this miracle of IT technologies through our Zoom platform. We already have 92 participants who have joined us. We still receive greetings from Paraguay, El Salvador, also from INSES, from Venezuela, from Costa Rica. So I would like to very briefly begin and tell you that this conference, even though it is open for Latin America and the Caribbean, this will have simultaneous interpretation, as Jimena said. We have also invited to this conference participants on credentials, but we have also invited other people from other institutions in order to take advantage of this experience that Anastasia will be sharing with us. I would now like to give the floor to Anastasia, then she will be making her presentation. After the presentation and during the presentation, you can send us questions through the chat. And by the end, we will try to summarize them so that Anastasia can respond to some of them. And then we will be closing this conference. The 14 people from INADE have joined us. So we want to say hi to INADE team, Zenaida, Jasmine, Juan Jose, Liliana, also in Panama. Anastasia, please be welcome. Thank you so much, Fernando. Kalimera from Greece. That's good morning from Greece, from Thessaloniki. I speak Spanish, but my colleagues tell me that I need to practice more. But you know how these things are. You're kind of afraid of making mistakes, but I'm so happy to be here with you. And now I will be speaking English.
I would like to first share my screen and then hoping that you can all see it. Fernando, is it okay?
Yes, okay. Yes, we have seen.
So yes, I'm very happy to be with all of you here today. I was asked to present to you this important research that CEDEFOP, the Agency for Vocational Education and Training, has actually started a long time ago, that is called Micro-Credentials for Vet and Labor Market Learning. This is a very important piece of research we have done because CEDEFOP is really keen on understanding better what and how in the best way countries, at least in Europe, because we are a European agency, how these countries in Europe understand this whole concept of micro-credentials. And essentially, we wanted to understand what is happening in vocational education and training and labor market learning. This is a very important angle of our work, because when we started back in 2020, we realized that there has been a lot of literature and a lot of discussions mainly focusing on higher education. But we felt the need to understand better what is happening with labor market, with all these types of certifications and credentials that are existing out there. So our research is actually composed of three main areas. The first thing that we wanted to understand is this, let's say, perception or conceptions in Europe, how European citizens understand micro-credentials as a term, what it essentially means for Europe. And because when and actually before the European Commission published this very important, let's say, recommendation on micro-credentials, like more generally, but particularly with a focus here in VET, we wanted really to understand, you know, how the concept is formed, what are, let's say, the main characteristics behind this term micro-credentials. So we did a lot of, let's say, a very important mapping exercise for 1 year and a half, and we used different research methods. We tried to develop an extensive interview program. We also developed questionnaires and surveys that were directed and targeted to specific target groups in Europe. We did not only ask policymakers what they think, but we also targeted employers, employees, vet providers, national authorities, because their voice matters a lot. And their opinion is really different. It's not the same, for example, for an employee, what, for instance, is a micro-credential. Of course, this is very different if you would ask a vet provider in a European country. We were also very much interested in the links and important connection between micro-credentials and evolving qualification systems. Quite often in Europe, we discuss a lot that this phenomenon of micro-credentials is something that needs to be, let's say, trusted. And this is the case when it is linked with existing qualification frameworks, for example. And thirdly, we were very much interested in the added value of micro-credentials for end users. This is very important because only if end users realize the potential, the benefit of micro-credentials, only then we really understand there is a kind of a value. And of course, there's a future with this new phenomenon. Of course, there is an advisory group that has supervised our work. This is composed of representatives of member states, of governments in Europe, European Commission, but also trade unions and social partners. And their voice mattered a lot throughout our study. Now, the results from the first theme that we work on are the following. You can see them in the slide. We realize that micro-credential is actually an umbrella term. It is a more broader, let's say, term that can actually appear in different ways. Quite often, countries in Europe, we talk about micro-credentials by using the term micro-certificate, micro-qualification, open badges, digital badges, even nano degrees. So there were different terms that were used. But what is very important is that there has been a lot of uncertainty that is linked not only to the term, to the naming, but mainly to the function. And for us, this is a very important finding. Quite often, for example, countries in Europe would tell us that modules or partial qualifications and their characteristics resemble how, let's say, the European definition of micro-credentials is being shaped. I mean, what are, let's say, thinking about the characteristics behind. But then we would have critical voices, for example, from trade unions that would tell us, no, you cannot really compare qualifications to micro-credentials because they felt there was a kind of a threatened area. However, what we saw from our, let's say, targeted mapping exercise was that micro-credentials usually indicate a title, a date of issuing. We would have details on the identity of the holder, who would be the provider, and also the achieved learning outcomes. And this was very important. We also saw that these types of credentials that were considered micro-credentials, they were addressing mainly diverse learners. So it was not only learners themselves, but rather employees, new hires, but even customers of a company and quite many others. Quite often we would also have adults that would be very much interested in acquiring these type of credentials. And we realized also in this first theme of our work that non-formal micro-credentials are many, and they appeared mainly to address the limitation of formal qualification systems. And in essence, this limitation is related to the, let's say, lack or not being there willing to respond to what is actually being asked from labor market. So in essence, we need to consider why these micro-credentials have really played a prominent role in this politically, if we think about it, in this new ecosystem that is being formed. So this is a very important finding. Now, as I said before, and Fernando mentioned it, this is a nice window to Thessaloniki. This is actually a capture of Aristotle Square in Greece, in Thessaloniki, is a very famous area. And of course, SEDEFOP is in this part of the world. So what we were really interested in was to understand better what is the link between qualification systems, right? So already the findings I can share with you are the following. First and foremost, micro-credentials do not present something new. It's not actually a very innovative tool per se. But rather what is the innovative thing behind is that it is a way to define better and standardize what is already existing. And this is quite important. Of course, there is a lot of activity taking place because micro-credentials are appearing not only in the formal sector, but mainly in the non-formal sector. Not only the public area, but mainly the private, area. So for this reason, we saw that the way they are incorporated or included into national qualification systems varies a lot. In countries in Europe are very diverse. They have different historical departures, different starting points, if I may. And at SEDEFO, we study a lot within the bigger project that we do, which is called the future of VET, the future of vocational education and training. We study a lot, the historical development of qualification systems in countries. And we see, of course, very developed. So taking this into account, we also see that there is, a varied and diverse way with regards to how these micro-credentials will be linked into existing qualification systems. However, there are two main developments that have paved the way forward towards this direction. The first and the most important one is what I've already mentioned, this modularization of qualifications. We had replies from different, national qualification authorities in different countries that they were telling us that modules and partial qualifications resemble a lot to micro-credentials. So we see that in countries that this is already taking place, this can be considered a favorable condition towards including micro-credentials in the framework. A second important development is related to national qualification frameworks that are opening up to qualifications that are outside formal system. These are non-formal qualifications. Quite often validation of non-formal learning is very important in this perspective. But of course, not all countries in Europe at least are opening up their frameworks towards this situation. However, I can say that this is already a trend, and all the more, even more, let's say, countries are trying to go towards that direction. Of course, quite often in the discussion we have, or at least from the meetings and the webinars I'm participating, is this important aspect of recognition of prior learning, this RPL, as we call it. We use this acronym in Europe. This is very important. And what we see from our study and the findings of this research is that micro-credentials cannot only be an outcome of an RPL process, but can also be a tool. And I have a dedicated slide for you to see that and why I'm using this, let's say, specific argumentation. And last but not least, quality assurance always, always comes as one of the main hindering factors when it is not existing, and of course, enabling factors when it is there. And we see that quite often different, let's say, representatives of national authorities, of ministries of education would tell us that a micro-credential can be trusted and can be considered as having quality when it is, let's say, an outcome perhaps of an RPL process, but also when it is, let's say, a building block of formal qualifications. So in essence, it can be linked to an existing qualification system. So this is important. Quality assurance as a dimension is quite essential in that sense. Now, this slide shows you three different boxes that I will, you know, try to use my cursor to show you. And it actually paints the picture of what is happening in Europe. So we see that in European countries, discussions are quite varied if you think about the policy level discussions. And I have placed them in different, let's say, colored boxes to show you exactly right now what is happening, what are the stages of development. For example, if we go to the first box, I would just take, for instance, Cyprus, which is an important country here in this respect. And we see that the term micro-credential began to be used during discussions on the establishment of the European education area. And it is gradually receiving even more attention. And in particular, the concept has been discussed in the domains of vocational education training, higher education, and adult education as a way to strengthen lifelong learning. This is very important. However, in Czechia, both the concept and the purpose of micro-credentials are the subject of discussions that currently take place within the Ministry of Education, Youth and Sport, the National Pedagogical Institute of Czech Republic, and the Czech National Agency for International Education and Research. So you see, there are different bodies that have an important role to play here. However, if we go to the more advanced policy discussion, we see, for instance, that Slovakia is a very good country example because they have developed a strategy in 2021. And this strategy is about lifelong learning and guidance from 2021 to 2030. And they are including a specific thematic area, and they are referring to the following. They want to increase the flexibility of their qualification system with micro-credentials. So this is very important. So they have a concrete action plan. However, if we go to the last, let's say, box, the last blue box, we see that there are countries in Europe where they have introduced legislation. Such a country is Spain. So the VET law in Spain, which is an organic law quite recently adopted, they have established a completely new system of formal vocational education and training. They have even created a kind of a grading that spans from micro training, as they call it, which is grade A, to degrees and specialized courses to grade D or grade E. They use this labeling, and this is based on learning progression. And of course, at the end, they would obtain a kind of a certification or degree. So they use a lot this in their context, these micro training modules. So this is important. Now, how, let's say, in what sense modularization is linked to micro-credentials? I will not read everything here in this slide, and Fernando will be sharing the slides I'm presenting here today with you following this webinar and this workshop. But you can see the diversity in different countries, the diversity in terms of terms, definitions, but also in terms of function. For example, in Ireland, which is a very, let's say, advanced country in this case, just to tell you that Ireland has been using micro credentials more than 20 years now. And what they do is they try to accommodate, in essence, what they call freestanding qualifications, even as small as 5 credits, and they are very important. They have a very flexible qualification frameworks, and they use, and they are using those type of qualifications as a kind of a stepping stone into qualifications that they have in their frameworks. Of course, modularization is quite, let's say, important and useful for adult learning, and modules are very much, for instance, what you see in the first part here in the slide, very much considered similar to micro-credentials, and countries that have informed us are Belgium, Denmark, Hungary, and many others. So this is, let's say, the image with regards to this aspect. But also, as I said, there are countries that are opening up frameworks to micro credentials. And here, for instance, I would refer to the Maltese case, which is the second bullet point in my slide, where they are actually using the term awards. These micro-credentials are awards, and they are already part of their the Maltese qualification framework. They could be considered as a type of micro-credentials. And at the moment, what they are trying to do is they are trying to update their referencing report. This is a very important report that the country is using in line with the European qualification framework. And they would like to integrate micro-credentials like very clearly in a transparent way in their system. Polish qualifications are interesting. They are called market qualifications. There are quite many in the number, and they are considered micro-credentials. There is an increasingly even more, a bigger number, let's say, and they're including them in their integrated qualification system, as they call it, IQS. Now, with regards to RPL, as I said earlier, this is an illustrative slide. It actually shows you how micro-credentials can be used as a tool of RPL. What we saw, and there are specific examples in Europe, we saw that micro-credentials can be used to obtain a partial qualifications, but also they can act as a building block to something bigger. This is very much related to accumulation and stackability of micro-credentials. We use a lot of these words in Europe. We also see that micro-credentials can be used to gain access to an education program, for example, by allowing a VET program, somebody, let's say, follows this kind of program in VET and then gaining access to higher education, which is the case, for instance, in Ireland, but even gaining an exemption from part of an education program and even to have a shortened duration, which is the case, for instance, in the Belgium Flemish community. So, of course, all these data are available from micro-credentials report at CEDEFOP, and further on, I will add the link to those reports in the chat. Here, very briefly, I will show you a very concrete sectoral exercise we have done on manufacturing and retail. These are two sectors that were very interesting for CEDEFOP. And what we saw was the following. We have done a mapping exercise of 40 concrete micro-credentials for different countries in Europe within that sector. And what we immediately saw from this data, empirical data, is that these type of credentials are very highly targeted and specialized types of training. This is important. So if we move away from the term and we look at the function or the type of credential, we see that it is mainly focused around specific occupational profiles. We also saw that there is a focus on new and emerging topics and technologies. For instance, in this case, in manufacturing, this is related to 3D printing, right? So this is mainly for industrial applications. So we see these more emerging, let's say, technologies and micro-credentials playing an important role. We also see that there is diversity in duration. Quite often we discuss this, we use the term notional workload. This is related to the timing that somebody would need to get this credential. And we see that there is a lot of diversity. It can last from days, from hours to days, even months. So there's a lot of, let's say, variety in that sense, and countries are free to do so. There's not a kind of directive that would say these type of credentials in that type of duration is a good credential and that other is better or worse, you see. So there's a lot of diversity, and at least in Europe, this is very well accepted. Of course, the mode of delivery differs. It can be online, it can be on, let's say, on the job even training quite often. It can be blended. It can, depending who is the provider, it can be offered in a classroom setting or in apprenticeship setting. So there is a lot of diversity in delivery. And finally, we see that some of those mapped micro-credentials, in essence, 23 out of 39, would explicitly describe learning outcomes. And this is very, very important because learning outcomes is considered the common language. It actually shows the knowledge, skills, and competencies of the end users, the holders of those types of credentials. Now, of course, there are emerging questions that came from our research. The first and foremost is the following. Can these types of certificates, sectoral or professional certificates that are awarded mainly based on the completion of a performance-based assessment be considered micro-credentials? This is a very important question that maybe is of use to you in Latin America, perhaps in your countries, to consider. And in what sense can we regulate, standardize, or even formalize this process? Does it make sense to mimic what is already existing in the labor market if we think about sector and professional skill certificates? Is it really needed to regulate? I would say no. I would actually, it's a rhetorical question, but the thing is that if we do that, then we would risk this flexible nature of credentials, because this is the reason why they have emerged. They have emerged as a way to say something to the more traditional qualification systems in that sense. So in our effort to regulate them or standardize them, we might make some, you know, mistakes in that sense. And of course, is there a need to rebrand what is already functioning well in the labor market or something that is already well accepted? Perhaps not. Perhaps we need to see whether these type of new, at least new micro-credentials, I mean, what is their function, their use, and what is the added value, as I will immediately go to the next, again, nice Thessalonican window. What is the added value for end users? Because we need to consider that micro-credentials are part of a broader system of qualifications and credentials with multiple stakeholders, multiple learning contexts. So we need to see whether individual learners can really trust them. And of course, what kind of support is needed and how ideally in the future micro-credentials can play a more targeted role in supporting what we consider age-neutral systems for vets. And when I'm referring to age-neutral, I mean all types of learners, young, adults, people who have left education and would like to go back to it, different types of people, not without any gender bias or any type of bias, I would say. So really, we need to consider this equity inclusion dimension here in that perspective. So just to tell you, which is, let's say, the third and final part of my presentation, is that what we did in order to understand the specific issues for end users, we conducted a very important survey program. And this program was launched targeting four stakeholder groups: employers, employees, students and other learners, and finally individuals who are unemployed. And you know, this is very important. This type of let's say profile groups really can tell us what is happening in practice. We ran an important survey in December 22 until January 2023. We ran four different types of surveys that were translated in eight different languages in Europe. We used the Alkmaar survey tool. And of course, you already see the result of the first, let's say, a result that I can share with you, is that in the question, whether these people consider or have they already made use of micro-credentials for training purposes, we actually saw that 38% of the replies told us that they are currently trying to find out what it is and in what sense they can be of value to them. So I think that this is important as a percentage. It actually shows that more than a third of the respondents across the specific stakeholder groups noted this issue. However, we cannot be that pessimistic if we consider that, let's say, there are other people that have already made use. I mean, we already see this 13% there. This is already an important number. And there is a 20% figure there that says that they are currently considering, you know, that they really want to make use of them in the near future. So I would say that the picture that is being formed is really varied. At the moment, we still need some time to ripe for this credential phenomenon to become more mature and more widely accepted. And we can be, let's say, optimistic in that sense. This is a very dense slide. I'm only showing to you just to show you that what we did at SEDEF is that we try to have this more broad thinking, and that we wanted to really understand the opinions and the perception of learners, education training providers, and employers. And mainly when we are in the process of discussing trust, how trust can be perceived within the different target groups, we realize that there are specific conditions to be met. What I have in the vertical columns as a pre-engagement process, actually this column is telling us that micro-credentials cannot be operate in a silo, in a vacuum. In order to make them work, these preconditions need to be considered. And actually, if you zoom in and see, for instance, what is important for learners, for instance, this more personalized guidance that is needed for education training providers, there are other, let's say, benefits that how, for instance, the staff is engaged, what kind of funding is there for them, but also for employers, we see, for instance, what are the business cases that are existing, or for instance, how much they consider them as an important labor force, let's say, element. So there are different, let's say, aspects to be considered. But of course, if we go to the last, very last column about impact, so we're discussing pre-engagement, the actual engagement process, the added value, but then if we are going to really put our eyes on impact, we would see we would only have some indications because we would need something which is more systemic, systemic outcomes and impacts of engagement with micro-credentials that could take years to materialize. So you see, we are still have some time ahead of us. Of course, there are, as I say, different benefits for different target groups. On the right side, you see some nice graphic visual. This came about from an important conference we did at SEDEFOP in November 2021 when we started our research. And it actually shows, I like this figure that it shows this girl that is looking from her microscope. She tries to zoom in on the specific characteristics of micro-credentials that are out there. And she's doing that as a part of her lifelong learning journey. And there are different angles and dimensions to be considered. But you also see this nice graph with the wolf. And we quite often we are asking, is it a wolf in sheep's clothing or is it the other way around? So is it really something new or are we still, you know, trying to discuss how best to name what is already existing? So there are different aspects that we need to consider and definitely different benefits for end users as you see in this slide. I would say this triangle is important. First and foremost, we need user-centered and career guidance and counseling processes in place. I think this is the way forward because this would have a very positive impact on employability and labor market mobility, because career guidance can assist individuals at different stages of learning and working lives. But for sure, we need to see what are the available resources. In Europe, there are different tools. There has been the European Skills Agenda of 2020 that has been, let's say, a milestone ahead. And of course, trade unions' voices can play an important role in guiding learners and employees, regardless of their status, due to their insights and connections in labor market. At the same time, I'm referring to funding and continuing training. I think this is very important. In Europe, we have ESF, the Erasmus program, the Individual Learning Account Scheme, different types of measures that are intended to increase opportunities for European workforce to participate in continuous training. Of course, their potential needs to be released in the future. And finally, in that triangle is this aspect of systemic and organizational support measures. And I think that there has been different skills-based approaches to assessment, to recognition. CEDEFU has been doing a lot of work on skills forecasting and other measures that I think that are really needed and are of use also for countries outside Europe, definitely. There's a vision for the future, different scenarios that can be developed from a European micro-credentials registry to having an ideal situation of countries opening up their frameworks to even more incremental approaches based on metadata, on ease and comparability figures. But all of these different scenarios have their pros and cons. And actually, if we think about that, it's the user's perspective that is very important. It is then that we need really to consider, you know, what is the current situation, always reflecting the diversity of provision out there. I would say that micro-credentials can be conceptualized as components in dynamic skills ecosystem. They can be local, sectoral, transsectoral, even transnational. These discussions are very much linked also to value chain connectivities, to labor market outcomes. There are different dimensions, but for sure, we definitely need to allow some time, as I said earlier, for all of these, let's say, different developments to become more, let's say, holistic and to be able for us also to see all these concrete benefits for the end users. Yes, this is a nice image. I would like you, please, all of you, the participants in this meeting, to note down the date of a very important virtual event that CEDEFU is currently preparing for next week. This is a virtual event. We will be using also the social media accounts and the Twitter hashtag micro-credentials. This is an online event that CEDEFU will be presenting all the findings of this research. As I have already presented to you, we have invited participants around the globe. We already have 330 people registered, so I will be posting the link to register in case you would be interested to participate. I would be happy to see you there as well. And all the insights from Latin America, from the different countries that Fernando was telling me, from Brazil, from Chile, from Peru, all the different countries are so useful for us in Europe. And I think we should really open up the discussion to everybody, really to see this phenomenon as becoming more global, and perhaps to really question whether it is a labor market megatrend or not. Let's see. I think for me, I like as a Greek person to raise this rhetoric Greek questions even on what is actually happening. I would like to thank you very much for your attention. Here in this slide, you can see the link to the project page and also to a podcast we have done at CEDEFU, where we're discussing with my colleagues what exactly is happening with this situation and how micro-credentials are perceived. So, muchas gracias por su atención and espero que puedas escuchar todo en inglés.
I hope you enjoyed my presentation.
I will stop sharing.
Con certeza, fue muy buena presentación, Anastasia. Muchísimas gracias.
Realmente, Anastasia, this was a great presentation. Thank you so much. It really opens up a great path for new questions. This is a research that I understand has made the result of micro-credentials becoming a trend, precisely the trend, the name of the event you have invited us to is precisely that one. And we believe that is the case too. We already have some questions from the participants. First question would be if micro-credentials are focused on modules of TVET programs. If that is the case, can you please explain what that link is like in terms of micro-credentials to modules?
So yeah, I'm also listening to the interpretation of Fernando just to make sure that I'm not losing any important information. Yeah, the links with modules. Yeah, this is a very important comment, and thank you for raising that. I said that what we see from the findings and the insights we collected from Europe is that modules, from their, let's say, their nature, and as I say, unit-based qualifications and partial qualifications, and their characteristics resemble a lot with micro-credentials. And what we saw is that whenever we have modularized systems in different countries in Europe, as I said, this is a kind of a paving the way towards including in the future these type of micro-credentials in existing qualification frameworks in different countries. And in essence, I mean, we can really explain that, because if you think about modules, it actually is a kind of a, sometimes I'm using what in the French community they use bloc de compétences, a kind of a building block where you have like this shorter type of qualification with shorter duration or credits, if I may, but you still have the basic standard elements behind, like assessment processes, let's say quality assurance arrangements, learning outcomes that are achieved and usually are shown with these shorter types of qualifications, let's say. So for sure, modules and micro-credentials are very much linked. Sometimes they would use the term itself to denote a micro-credentials, but what we said is that the characteristics of these module or partial qualification would resemble to how the way micro-credentials are designed or defined in the council recommendation, because this is important. This is our starting point, this definition in Europe. I will be posting also the links in the chat. I already did that for the event where participants can access and register, of course, if they would like to.
Gracias, Anastasia. Tenemos...
Thank you, Anastasia.
Otra pregunta.
We have another question. And this is about whether what we call credentials in our region in Latin America, which is also known as RPL, recognition of prior learning, can this be the object of micro-credentials too? That is to say, our certification process today can be issued in micro-credentials as well?
Just to understand the question, if it can be issued, as I said, that because micro-credentials are linked to RPL, they can be an outcome or a tool. For sure, if you have the recognition of prior learning processes, this is very important, and because it's in this way that you can issue a kind of a micro-credentials that takes on board what is taking place outside formal system, even prior learning or other types of skills and competencies that people acquire. So if I understood correctly the question, there are concrete links. And I'm happy to hear also that you are using the word, the acronym RPL as well, because this is not only Latin America, it's actually a heated debate that's also taking place in Europe. And with my participation last week in the European Training Foundation, where we had representation from the TVET group, which is a more global group. Imagine we have the like OECD, UNESCO, different other agencies, the most heated debate was surrounding the RPL process and how important this is and how much it is linked with the current situation.
Can you please tell us, give us some main lines about that debate? Which are the so-called hot issues in that debate, please?
As I said, the most important thing, is that in cases that you would need to see, or at least from the examples I showed you in the slide that I shared, is that in what context, in what cases RPL can be used as a kind of enabling factor to recognize micro-credentials. And we saw, for example, that in different countries, when you, I mean, but again, these different national systems are important here. For example, if you have a system that you have a kind of a full formal qualification, right, and then you need to recognize part of that, then if you have a robust validation or recognition system, then that would allow for the accumulation stackability of this credential to take place. In other cases, when you want to, let's say, get an exemption from a bigger program and you have a robust system that is really working, then you manage to do that. This is the case, for instance, in Denmark. So you see, depending on the different national context and specificities, and whenever you have RPL as a mechanism working and functioning, then of course it can allow, let's say, the certification and the recognition of that type of credential. Now, the issue is that when we are dealing with credentials that are from the private sector, and then for sure then in that context, you need to pay attention to who is the provider, because you really need to understand that we would like to discuss credentials that are of quality assured, that we are aware, that we know that the provider is has the quality assurance arrangements in place. So there are specific mechanisms ensuring that these type of micro credentials can be recognized, also coming from the private sector, but also being apparent recognized in the public system. And this is where the confusion, the difficulty lies, because again, we it cannot be the case that every type of company, for instance, or provider is in a position to issue a credential. It has to follow specific standard requirements and standard elements. And that is why the council recommendation on the topic has somehow set the scene and has actually specified which are the standard elements behind. And for sure, recognition and assessment processes need to be transparent, need to be, let's say, done in concrete ways. And these are aspects we really need to consider when discuss RPL.
Okay, gracias. Hay otra pregunta que voy a tratar
de dejar clara. There's another question, which I will try to clarify. Can micro-credentials be issued for parts of educational formal programs, for instance, for vet programs in terms of technology of medium education?
Technology of medium, because I'm thinking about the translation now. So it's about, so for technical, so Fernando, if you can also perhaps translate the last part of the question from your perspective in English, in the sense that from vet to higher education, or just okay, yeah, it is possible. I mean, but as I said, it is possible. The thing is that, as I said, we need to see which is the national context we refer to, as I say, how the qualification system is formed. For example, if we talk about vocational education training, like, for instance, in my country, in post-secondary vocational education training, there are parallel, let's say, types of programs of shorter duration that are considered micro-credentials and can be, let's say, integrated in the system. But we really need to see what kind of, for instance, if this program, what level it has, and whether it is formed in such way to allow for shorter types of programs to be recognized in the actual formal program, and then, of course, to be part, you know, part of that program. So for which country, for instance, that would be the case, if I may ask from the question that
was posed. Solo para tal vez just contribuir a la respuesta.
Maybe to contribute to the reply. In one of your first slides, you showed that micro-credentials are not something that are totally new, but which are something that can be adapted in terms of context and contents. It's probable that many credentials that we have in the region, which are module oriented or which are in small units of learning or skills, can be compared to this micro-credential concept. As I understand, the most important thing from your presentation is that they are aligned to a qualification system, also to a qualifications framework, if that exists, and that they have a quality assurance system that generates trust and which can be used by employers and also by advisors. So the concept itself has something that you mentioned before, which is a possibility of being stackable, such as the Lego games where you put one piece on top of another and you create a line, a progression line in terms of labor. So this is not a concept of isolated credentials that are not recognized, but credentials in the middle of a whole professional or labor path, which also are quality assured and which are also integrated to a qualifications system. I understand that that was the main part for this micro-credentials topic.
Yeah.
I would like to add another question. When you mentioned the supply of the private sector for micro certifications, after COVID, we had an explosion of micro credentials in different platforms such as Google, Coursera, et cetera, and other technological platforms as well. Are these micro-credentials actually? And second, what challenges do they have for national qualification systems?
Mm.
How is Europe observing that trend?
Yeah, very good question. Thank you for that. Exactly. We see, when we zoomed in on the sector level, specifically on IT, there's a lot of activity taking place there. Indeed, these are like Microsoft certification, Cisco certification, IBM, or Coursera, for example. Of course, they can be considered micro-credentials, but even a driver's license can be considered a micro-credential. So in essence, what we want to understand is what kind of specific knowledge, skills, and competences are hidden behind those type of different type of shorter types of certification. For instance, what we see in IT, maybe I can also give you some more examples, and then of course I will mention the challenges that you asked me. But the first, for example, we have another in the French context, we have a French digital service provider, which is called Groupe Orange. So what they do, they try to offer online courses on themes related to social responsibility and technology, even on digital equality, artificial intelligence, cybersecurity. So these type of courses are considered, for example, in that case, micro-credentials. On the other hand, we have in the German context, the key on open higher education, for instance, that they would provide also online courses for refugees using MOOCs, which are, let's say, shorter higher education courses or even open educational resources with the aim, let's say, to come closer to the labor market. So there are different vendor certifications, as we call them in IT, or industry specific certifications that are quite often perceived as micro-credentials. But of course, the questions that remain is which standards and certificates should be, as you rightly mentioned, part of more formal education and training programs, because you mentioned very nicely this metaphor of Lego, this accumulation stackability component. So you might have micro-credentials that have the potential to be linked as a Lego, as a kind of one brick towards a full qualification. But on the other hand, you might have these private vendor certifications or industry-specific certifications that are perfectly fine, not necessarily to be linked, but because the provider is a renowned one or because there are specific quality assurance arrangements in place, they are still very transparent and they can be considered, for instance, for recruitment purposes or for advancing in the labor market in general. So this is quite important. And then you asked me about the challenges in Europe. I would say that And I will repeat that in Europe, we see that micro-credentials cannot be seen currently as a threat in terms of replacing or substituting formal qualifications, for example. And this is quite important. What we see is that micro-credentials are largely seen as complementary to traditional education and training system as a way to reinforce their ability to respond to rapid changes in European labor market, and their portability and transferability, in essence, would depend on their visibility and perceived value. So, for instance, if you have a very trusted and renowned credential coming from the labor market, then this is fine. The thing is that the complexity might lie when you try to introduce it in a formal, robust, and traditional system. You really need to see, again, the specific criterion standards behind in what way possible it can be incorporated. And finally, for that comment, I would like to repeat the words of a German representative of employer organizations who told us in our survey program that micro-credentials are evidence of more practicable and flexible and on-demand learning experience. And they are very attractive in that sense. But what is very, very important is to find the appropriate balance between fostering trust and transparency, because all these discussions are related to trust, as a part of a common approach in Europe, but we need not to compromise their flexibility. So these more flexible micro-credentials quite often would appear in the private sector, in the labor market area. But as I said, who is the provider is very important. What kind of quality assurance arrangements are there? And in what sense the assessment processes or the performance-based assessments are actually taking place? So I tried a bit to reply more broadly in that sense, Fernando.
Yeah, very good. Creo que es un buen panorama.
Yes, very good. I believe this is quite a good overview.
Es una tendencia.
This is a trend that is becoming more and more strong. And I would like to emphasize that this is not unknown. We have seen short-term micro-credentials in the region before. I remember that SENA would issue micro-credentials that were called credits. So you could take credits for 40 or 50 hours and then accumulate them to obtain a qualification further on. Back then, this was a professional skills certificate. I'm talking about the 80s. But maybe a secretary could have a credit for typing or for stenography or for answering the phone or for drafting documents. And like that, that person could complete maybe broader certification. Now we have several advantages. One, it's easier to know the profiles because we have huge databases. We have ESCO, and there are several profiles to organize that. Two, it's easy to put that in a QS, in a qualifications framework. And these are not certificates or credentials that are isolated. So they can be stackable, as we say in English. And that's a great advantage. Here, our colleague from Jamaica, Marcia Grant, in the chat has mentioned that they have job qualifications. Mm-hmm. Those are their micro-credentials, which are part of the broader qualifications in order to respond to the labor market demands. So the important thing here is how to adapt that trend, how to always be able to manage transparency, trust, and flexibility, which you mentioned before. Mm-hmm. And also how to link that to the broader picture, which is the national qualification system of each country. We're getting to the end, Anastasia. You had also mentioned other commitments in terms of time. But there's another last question, if you are able to answer it. And this is from Argentina. We are asked whether you can also mention something about how we can have proposals for micro-credentials when people when workers want to avoid multitasking and having to perform many functions at the same time, and maybe when they can focus on specialization more. There's a debate whether I need to be highly specialized in something or whether I should have a more multitasking profile.
Unions in particular, have you discussed this issue with the trade unions?
Well, this is a very, very interesting comment. And with trade unions, we have discussed a lot and quite openly. And as I said at the beginning of our research, they have expressed real concerns, raising voices against considering micro-credential as a qualification per se, for the reasons I have explained during my presentation. And we made sure that at least in our understanding with the countries, this not to be mistaken. But with trade unions, with regards to the, well, the multitasking and the need to be more specialized or not, well, we didn't go into that detailed debate. But what I can say, I mean, the more you have, the better. Of course, I mean, because quite often it does not mean that because we have this fashion, this trend, as Fernando said earlier about micro-credentials, that we are forgetting the formal qualifications. Not at all. It can be the case that somebody can already have obtained different types of formal qualifications, but in order to meet to the labor market specific needs of a sector of occupation, he or she needs specific competencies that would make him or her fit for the job. So this is for in the lifelong learning journey for all of us, all adults and young people out there. And what I see is that micro-credentials, in essence, open the possibility for people to stack the specific competencies which can be documented and recognized afterwards by learning providers, by employers within the sector. And there are examples, like in Denmark. I always like replying to questions using examples, because this is like the argument behind, like in Denmark, there is, for example, there are labor market training courses, specific dedicated training courses that offer various upskilling pathways for people. They are so well developed and recognized, and they can, in essence, form the basis for lots of other initiatives using micro-credentials. And the thing is that you need to have a kind of a mechanism in a country, and depending on the sector, because trade unions, because of their concrete, let's say, connection with what is requested in the occupation, in the sector, they have the awareness and the knowledge to alert, for example, what types of competencies and skills are needed for that sector, so as to warn the employees, even have some kind of training further or information sessions to say that what are these specific skills and competencies that are needed to make the best of your profile in a specific job. And the other thing that is very important, quite often I also experience it myself, is that we all learn on the job. All of us, that we are working as adults, when we are working, right? I think we acquire indirectly all these different occupation-related specific competencies. So the important thing is that you learn as you work and you grow as you are working. I would say is more having this more philosophical thinking, is that you never stop learning. So in that sense, I would say, yes, specialization is definitely needed and appreciated, but you never know that you will stay in this job forever. We are always trying to become more mobile. We also try to develop within that work. So acquiring these different types of credentials, micro-credentials, can help you a lot, because in essence, you try to document what was already happening informally or indirectly somehow. So I think it can only be beneficial in that sense, Fernando. For sure, trade unions' voice is important. We need to be open to hear them. But yeah. You're muted, Fernando.
Okay, sí, gracias. Le recuerdo a nuestros queridos
Let
y queridas
me remind all participants
que estamos sobre el tiempo.
That we are running short of time, unfortunately, and therefore we will have to give the floor to Jimena for the closing. Thank you, Anastasia. Once again, please don't leave us yet.
No, no, no.
Thank you, Fernando and Anastasia. I'm sharing a closing survey so participants can answer a few questions and score your comments on this activity. Let me remind you that the presentation will be part of module 3 of our course, and then it will be also shared in the bulletin and in Center 4's website. That's all fair, I have to say. Should we turn on our video cameras and so that we can take a picture? Some people are greeting us through the chat.
Wow, perfect. I would like to take a photo, can I, with my mobile phone?
Me encantaría.
Gracias, muchas gracias por eso, Fernando.
And we'll send you a photo for Anastasia. We'll send you the photo.
Bien, tenemos bastantes cámaras encendidas.
So we have several cameras on.
Llegamos a 133 participantes.
We had 133 participants, plus the INADE group, which is working all together. So we have a lot
more. Yeah. Yes, es casi 150 con
almost
las 14 personas.
Almost 150 participants in the activity today.
Perfect.
Excelente, Anastasia. Más
well,
una
Anastasia,
vez, muchísimas
once
gracias.
Again, thank you.
Como a todos y todas las
and
participantes
also,
en este evento. Vamos a continuar compartiendo algunos otros conocimientos
we
y tendencias que nos vienen de Europa. La próxima
Europe,
va a ser el 27 de junio con la presentación
27,
y un poco un taller un poco más focalizado sobre la clasificación europea de cualificaciones. Allí vamos a invitar un grupo de instituciones, tenemos un poco
we'll
más de restricciones, pero ya colocaremos el video para que lo puedan ver todos.
So,
Anastasia, thank you very
Anastasia,
much. ¿Cómo es? Gracias.
Muchas
en
gracias.
Griego,
how do you say thank you in,
ah,
in Greek?
Yes. Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Solo recuerdo que suma se dice logaritmo, ¿no?
Logaritmo is addition. That's
así
all
que
I
bueno, muchas gracias.
Logariasmos.
Logariasmos.
Okay. Ese era un mi dolor de cabeza en la secundaria.
That was a headache for me, learning Greek.
Yeah. Así que muchas gracias.
Not language, I know.
Un gran saludo. Gracias
well,
a Jimena, nuestras traductoras también. Lo han hecho muy bien. Muchísimas gracias, Anita.
Job.
A Mateo que estuvieron por allí
Mateo,
atrás de bambalinas ayudándonos con toda esta tecnología y con la difusión de este evento y bueno, seguimos viéndonos un
so
gusto
we'll
y hasta la próxima videoconferencia que tengan
time.
Buen resto de
bye
día
bye.
Bye bye Anastasia thank
hasta
you.
Luego
gracias.
Gracias.
Gracias
a todos
gracias
feliz día
gracias
desde Venezuela
chao, saludos de también
greetings from Venezuela.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
Gracias, muchísimas
no.
Gracias de Haití.
Ah,
gracias,
Fabricio.
Fabricio.
Thank you, Fabricio.
Ahí está Ramona todavía, un gusto. Nuestra Ramona querida. Ok.
De Venezuela, muchas gracias. Excelente, excelente actividad.
Excelente
okay.
Activity.
Nos alegra,
Juan
de Dios, que estés bien. Chao, chao.
Gusto, Fernando. Hasta luego.
Thank you, Fernando. Thank you, everybody.